Our story begins way back in history, in the year of 1957. As a point of reference, David O. McKay was the president of the church and had been for the prior 6 years. He would continue serving as president of the church for another 13 years. He was the prophet of our youth. At that time, there were only 12 temples in the church, including 4 outside of the United States. In those days, a gallon of gas cost 31 cents. Dwight D. Eisenhower was the president of the United States. And as a note important to a teenager at that time, Johnny Mathis, one of the greatest voices of all time, just had one of his first hit singles titled Chances Are. More about that later. We attended the Grant Ward in Bell Gardens, California. It was a small ward with a strong youth program and excellent youth leaders. On a Tuesday evening, late in September of 1957, after school started, the youth had a dance in the cultural hall of our building. The music was provided by whoever had any records they wanted to bring. They were played on a little box phonograph. For some reason, that evening I was in charge of putting on a new record whenever the current one was finished. Yes, one record at a time. Remember, this was 1957. As it happened, someone had brought a 45 RPM record of the new Johnny Mathis song, Chances Are. So, when someone asked for a slow dance, I put it on. While it was playing, I worked up the nerve to ask the cutest girl in the ward if she wanted to dance. Much to my delight, she accepted. But the song was over much too soon. I really liked dancing with her, so a few songs later, I put the Chances Are record back on again, and once again asked that cute little teenager for a dance. Again, she accepted. I found myself putting that record on again, and again, and again, through the rest of the evening. Fortunately, the following Saturday was a steak dance at our steak center in Huntington Park. I asked that cute little girl if she would like to go with me. Amazingly, she agreed. So, that next Saturday, September 28th, was the date of our first date. Even to this day, rarely does a month go by without one of us wishing the other a happy 28th day, regardless of the month. When I say first date, I may be using the term a little loosely. I did ask her to go with me, and she did say yes. But my dad drove us there and picked up 2 or 3 other kids that went with us. Following the dance, Dad dropped off the others first, allowing us to have a little time alone for the few minutes it took for him to chauffeur us to her house. Thanks, Dad. Luckily, I got to see her each morning as we attended early morning seminary together. All of the youth in our ward attended the same class, from the freshmen to the seniors. In addition, there was no institute program in our area, so we had 3 or 4 college students in our class too. That came to over 30 students, all from our ward. We met in the same classroom, the Relief Society room, all 4 years, with the same teacher, Sister Allen. Imagine teaching 30 kids ranging from freshmen to college students. Actually, she did just fine. We secretly referred to her as General Allen. It was no surprise that the cutest girl in the class was my incentive for perfect attendance. We went to the junior prom and the senior prom. Both were held at the Ambassador Hotel in Los Angeles. we also participated in all the dance festivals, all the youth sports programs, all the plays and activities, and even some extracurricular activities. We saw a lot of each other in those high school years. Isn't that cute? Here we are, from the yearbooks, in our junior and senior years. We graduated from high school in 1960, and for the next couple of years, she worked in Huntington Park for Pacific Bell as an IBM key punch operator. This was the dawn of the computer age. While I attended Los Angeles Technical College, earning my associate degree, JoAnn continued her job as an IBM key punch operator while I served my mission in Ireland. And in her spare time, she faithfully and frequently wrote to her missionary. Upon returning from my mission, it didn't take long. I returned home at the end of May, and we soon set our wedding date for July 3rd. The invitations were mailed, and all the plans were made. In those days, the bride and groom attended a full temple session and instruction session before their sealing, so it made for a very early day. Following our session and instructions, we went into the celestial room. This is the celestial room of the Los Angeles Temple. It is much like the rest of the temple, very beautiful, very peaceful, and very large. On the right side of the room, you will notice there are two steps up. This leads to two ceiling rooms, one on the left and one on the right. Here is our ceiling room. Immediately following our ceiling, the entire wedding party went upstairs to another ceiling room where my mom and dad were sealed. My patient mother had waited over 29 years for this. In those days, no one ever used the front or back door to the temple, and the bride was not to wear her wedding dress as she left the temple. Everyone entered and exited through a little door on the east side of the temple. And here is the bride and mother of the bride. Before we continue on, I would like to point out what may be one of the earliest recorded photo bombings. That's my 12-year-old little brother. Officially sealed in the Los Angeles Temple by the Temple President, President Bowing. Here, also, are my mom and dad on the day of their sealing. Later that evening, we returned to the Grant Ward building for our reception. And here we are, just as our reception was about to start. Here are our dads discussing whatever it is that the fathers discuss at a wedding. And then our reception. That night, following our reception, we drove up the Coast Highway 101 to Santa Barbara to stay for two nights. We both had to be back to work on Monday morning. Now, back in those days, motel prices were pretty consistent. For example, Motel 6 charged $6 a night, and the much more expensive Super 8 Motel charged $8 a night. Super. Well, for our honeymoon, we really splurged. We stayed in an ocean view balcony room on the second floor of the West Beach Inn in Santa Barbara. It was embarrassingly expensive. We paid, don't tell anybody, $18 a night. Both mornings, we walked a half a block down from the inn, where we again splurged and ate at our favorite breakfast restaurant. Here is the view from our room right across the street from the ocean and marina. So, on our second night, July 4th, we were able to sit and watch the July 4th fireworks from our balcony. $18 a night, worth every penny. By the way, I just looked it up. To stay in that same room this 4th of July weekend comes to just over $500 a night. Whew! We got there just in time. The following day, we drove back to Bell Gardens to our first home, a duplex near the high school. The rent per month was $70. Good thing both of us were working. And we lived happily ever after.